On the special build edition of the AI show, learn more about the differential privacy research that powers White Noise from Salil Vadhan, leader of the Privacy Tools Project at Harvard University. Make sure you tune in.
Hello, I am Salil Vadhan, a computer science faculty member at Harvard University. I'm excited to tell you about differential privacy, White Noise, the system we are building in collaboration with Microsoft, and OpenDP, the larger open source community effort it is feeding into. Before jumping into the science, I'd like to mention that my own start in differential privacy came with two wonderful visits to the Microsoft Research Silicon Valley Lab. With just 2 months in 2008, my collaborations with Microsoft researcher Cynthia Dwork and others led to my first four papers on differential privacy, a topic which I am still working on to this day. What is the motivation for differential privacy? It was the realization that the publication of what seems to be even innocuous aggregate statistics can lead to severe privacy risks. What do we mean by aggregate statistics? These can be publications of statistical tables as done by government agencies like the Census Bureau, the releasing of trained machine learning models as done by tech companies, and it can also include interactive query systems where analysts can present queries of their own, like a regression they'd like to run, and get back results. Such query systems are often used in practice in hope that not giving analysts direct access to sensitive data will protect privacy. However, we now know that we have to be very careful even with statistical aggregates. In the early 2000s, Dunier and Nissim proved a mathematical theorem saying that the publication of too many accurate aggregate statistics, each one just a simple random count, allows an adversary to reconstruct almost the entire underlying sensitive data set. The U.S. Census Bureau internally applied a form of this attack to the billions of statistics they released from the 2010 census and discovered that they could reconstruct and re-identify a significant fraction of responses from individual households, motivating them to modernize their disclosure limitation methods and adopt differential privacy for the 2020 census. Related vulnerabilities have been found for genetic data and machine learning models. To hammer this point home with a concrete example, a couple of years ago, Reddit users discovered that if you entered nonsense into Google Translate, it would start spitting out passages from the Bible verbatim. Why did this happen? It turns out that the millions of parameters in the deep neural net doing translation, which again seem like statistics aggregated over a huge training data set, had inadvertently memorized some of the training examples. Now, this may not be so worrisome when it's passages from the Bible, but imagine a system trained on emails or personal images or medical data. What's the message from all this? It's not that all statistical releases are always dangerous, but rather we need a quantitative theory to tell us how much is too much. How to ensure that we are not publishing too much statistical information too accurately and be sure that it can't be combined to yield such attacks. Differential privacy offers such a quantitative theory. In doing so, it aims to allow statistical analysis, such as drawing inferences about a population from which a dataset is drawn, training machine learning models that generalize, while mathematically ensuring that individual level data is not leaked, no matter what attack strategy is used by an adversary and what kind of auxiliary information an adversary has in hand. How is differential privacy achieved? It is achieved by injecting small amounts of random noise into statistical computations to obscure the effect of each individual while still allowing useful statistical signal to come through. In a bit more detail, differential privacy requires that even if an adversary is interacting with the system, choosing queries to try to learn about a specific individual in the dataset, what it sees should be essentially the same as if we had removed that individual's data from the dataset and replaced it with arbitrary other values. More precisely, for any two datasets that differ on one individual's data, like a dataset with your data in it and one with your data removed or modified, the probability distribution of results seen by the adversary should be essentially the same. How close these probability distributions are is given by what's called the privacy loss parameter, often denoted epsilon. The smaller epsilon is, the greater the level of privacy protection, and hence the greater amount of noise that needs to be introduced. This is the sense in which differential privacy offers a quantitative theory of privacy. I don't have time to tell you about how differentially private algorithms are constructed, which can be quite sophisticated, but already, as of 6 years ago, there was a wide theoretical literature showing that many data analysis tasks can be done in a differentially private manner, and this has only exploded since then. There were also some remarkably general theorems saying a very wide range of statistical estimation and machine learning problems can be done with almost no asymptotic cost for differential privacy. That is, the amount of error due to the noise introduced for privacy vanishes more quickly than the sampling error as the size of your dataset grows. Another amazing theoretical possibility is that of generating rich synthetic data with differential privacy. That is, publishing a dataset consisting of artificially constructed records that preserve an exponentially large collection of statistical properties of the original dataset, yet does not leak noticeable information about any individual record from the sensitive data. There remain significant challenges to make these remarkable theoretical results on this and the previous slide practical, but they tell us that there is a lot we can hope for from differential privacy. Beyond all of this beautiful theory, we have also seen a number of exciting practical deployments of differential privacy in recent years. This includes the landmark decision by the U.S. Census Bureau that I mentioned earlier to use differential privacy for the 2020 census, as well as a number of deployments by large tech companies. All of these, however, are organizations with lots of in-house technical expertise to develop their own customized differential privacy solutions. So a goal of the work we are doing and our collaboration with Microsoft is to enable wider adoption of differential privacy. There are a number of challenges to achieving this, and our efforts address a number of them. We've been working towards this at Harvard in our interdisciplinary privacy tools project since 2012, and we're excited to now be working with Microsoft on the WhiteNoise system that is designed to be an end-to-end system that can allow non-experts to make effective use of differential privacy. We are also building on this experience to launch a larger community open source software project in differential privacy called OpenDP, in which collaborations between academia and industry can bring ideas from the research literature into production quality software that can be used by all. One use case, which has been a driver for our efforts at Harvard, is the incorporation of differential privacy into data repositories, such as the Dataverse software that others on our Harvard team have built and is used by social scientists and researchers around the world to share their data sets with others to verify, replicate, and extend their findings. Unfortunately, today, most data repositories are not equipped to take on privacy-sensitive data, and when they do, it is not made available for download. The only way to get access to such data is through a manual application and approval process, which can take months of negotiation between institutions. Our goal is to enable wider sharing of sensitive data while providing strong protections of privacy. We plan for a future version of WhiteNoise to have a simple graphical user interface that a researcher coming to deposit data in a Dataverse repository can use to release differentially private statistics about their dataset without having any prior expertise in differential privacy. Then another researcher can come, explore these releases, including the uncertainty coming from the noise introduced for privacy, as well as make queries of their own. To summarize, statistical releases do carry real privacy risks, and differential privacy provides the only principled way we know for avoiding them. There is a rapidly advancing science of how to get increased utility with differentially private releases, and we are all working together to turn this science into software. Thank you.